Happy Easter and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. I hope your Easter week is going very well. Thanks for spending part of it with us. We got open forum today with Jimmy Akin first hour, Tim Staples second hour, and we're not fundraising. I can't remember the last time we did that without asking you for money. So that's an extra bonus. Open forum means open to anyone, 888-318-7884. It also means open to whatever you would like to ask, 888-318-7884. Jimmy Akin is senior apologist here at Catholic Answers and the proprietor of Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. Hello, Jimmy Akin.
Hello, Cy Kellett. How you doing?
I'm doing very well. What I would like to know, though, what is dropping tomorrow on Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World?
Well, it's the first part of a pair of episodes that I've really been looking forward to for some time. I did a research a while back on what are known as after-death communications, or ADCs, where people just spontaneously, they're going about their business, and they suddenly hear from a departed loved one. It could involve the sense of sight. They might see their departed loved one. It could involve the sense of hearing. It could involve any of the five senses or none of the five senses. But the startling thing is how many people have these. Now, people don't tend to talk about them because other people might think they're crazy, since there's kind of a vicious cycle. You know, people don't talk about them because people don't talk about them, so they don't realize how common they are. But based on recent surveys, it appears that between 40% and 50%, so basically almost half of the population, reports at least one spontaneous after-death communication from a loved one at some point during their life. And so there are bunches of accounts of these. There's been good research done on them recently, like how often they occur, how often they repeat, what senses do they involve, what messages do the loved ones communicate to them. And so we're going to be doing a two-part look at them. Sometimes they contain what's known as veridical information, which is something that the living person did not previously know, but then checks out. Sometimes they even show up to deliver urgent warnings, like stop driving the truck now and you avoid a train crash. So there are some really fascinating stories, and we're going to be doing a two-part look. Part one is airing this Friday. Part two is going to be airing next Friday.
Wow, that's so cool, Jimmy. All right, so that'll drop tomorrow. The new episodes drop each Friday. It sounds like the next 2 week is going to be a lot of fun with ADCs.
Yeah.
After-death communications.
Lots of fun. Very interesting stuff.
888-318-7884 is the number if you'd like to talk with Jimmy here, and we'll do our very best to get you on the line. 888-318-7884. Let's go to the phones. We'll start with Severio in Oxford, Massachusetts, watching on YouTube. Severio, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Go ahead, Sam.
Hi. So when the Holy Spirit came on the apostles at Pentecost and they had the strength to go out and evangelize, like, right away with courage, the same thing is supposed to happen to us at confirmation. How come people don't, like, act the same way the apostles did, like going out right away with that courage?
Oh, all right.
Well, one of the things that has been discerned over the course of Christian history, and we can tell this even by reading the Bible, is that God acts with more intensity in some periods in time compared to others. If you study the Old Testament, for example, you'll find that there were periods where God was really giving a lot of prophecy, for example. His spirit was active in a very big way. Like, for example, at the time of Moses, lots of prophecy came through Moses. But then there are other periods where there's not so much prophecy. And an example of that was when the prophet Samuel was a boy. In fact, when Samuel was a boy and God was calling to him, he didn't recognize the voice of the Lord. And the author of 1 Samuel tells us that that's because when Samuel was a boy, visions were very rare in his day. God was not giving a lot of revelation. But then by the time Samuel was an old man, there were lots of prophets. There was lots of prophets. There was a whole school of prophets that would travel down the road prophesying that Saul temporarily joined when he became king. And then at the time of the Babylonian exile, there was another kind of drop off in the amount of prophecy that was happening. But then it picked up again in Jesus's day, and Jesus gave a lot of prophecy, and there were lots of Christian prophets in the early church in the first century. So we see that there are kind of waves in God's activity level, and they seem to be correlated or coincide. They seem to go along with major phases in God's plan, like Moses, that was a major phase in God's plan, or Jesus, that was a major phase in God's plan. So we expect there to be lots of spiritual impact from God's action in these major phases. We expect to see less of it as we get further from these major phases. And so as a result, most of Christian history, there are ups and downs in Christian history in terms of how much activity God is causing to happen, but we wouldn't expect it to be as intense as it was right at the beginning of the Christian age, right on the day of Pentecost, when the church needed to grow, especially, you know, because it was just starting. Once the church became established, then there's not as much need for this dramatic level of activity. And so God does give us the strength and confirmation to evangelize and to serve him in other ways, but it's a kind of quieter strength rather than a more dramatic strength. Now, sometimes people may get confirmed and instantly want to go out and boldly proclaim God's word. That can happen too. It's just not as common right now as it was on the day of Pentecost, because the church isn't in the same situation now. It doesn't need that same level of impact since the church is already well established now. So that's the basic reason. It can still happen today, but we don't expect it to, because we're not at a major turning point in God's plan the way the day of Pentecost was a major turning point in God's plan.
Okay, Saverio?
Yes, thank you.
Are you about to get confirmed?
Next year.
Yeah. All right. Well, if it's all right, I'd like to send you a book. Jimmy has a book called A Daily Defense, 365 Days Plus One to Becoming a Better Apologist. I think you'll enjoy the book very much. If you hang on, Edgar will get the information he needs, and we will send you a copy of that book. 888-318-7884 is the number here. It's open forum. Jimmy Akin is our guest. Nicholas is in Westlake, Ohio, watching on YouTube. Nicholas, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hey, Jimmy. I'm a big fan. I just want to apologize. The area, location I'm in is kind of loud, but I'll do my best to just do the question. It's about evolution and original sin. So it says in Romans chapter 5, verse 12, that death entered the world through sin, but with our knowledge of evolution, we know now that death and suffering was, like, always present on Earth, even before the first humans. So, for example, like, the dinosaurs were killing and eating each other millions of years before the first hominids ever entered the scene. And they were killing each other in pretty gruesome ways, too. So I'm just wondering, how is that compatible with God saying it is good to everything he creates in Genesis? Where did all the death and violence come from? Because we weren't even around to sin yet.
Okay, so you've raised a couple of issues there. Let me see if I can address both of them. The first one is, what does Paul mean when he says in Romans 5 that death entered the world through sin? The standard understanding of that, at least by theologians like St. Thomas Aquinas, would be that death entered the human world through sin. You know, if I say things like the whole world has heard about God, I would mean like the human world has heard about God. I don't mean all the amoebas and you know, lizards that are out there have heard about God. I mean the human world. And that's what Paul's talking about. Because if you look in the book of Genesis, all it says is Adam and Eve won't die if they don't fall. It never says anything about will other creatures die if they don't fall, or if man doesn't fall. And so theologians like St. Thomas Aquinas, and I would agree with Aquinas here, have said, you know, the nature of the animals didn't change. You know, lions were still predators before the fall. They still ate other you know, creatures before the fall. And I think that's right, because Genesis never says the contrary. It never says that nothing but man died before the fall. The only promise that was given was that if Adam and Eve didn't fall, then they wouldn't die. But it never says anything about any other creatures. In fact, if you look at the text carefully, it's clear that there was death before the fall, because God gave Adam and Eve the right to eat any of the trees, the fruit of any of the trees in the Garden of Eden, except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Well, when you eat fruit, guess what? You're biting into living tissue, and that living tissue dies because your stomach acid tears it apart so that your body can extract nutrients for it. So we can see right there was clearly plant death before the fall, and plant death is still death. So there was death before the fall. The only thing that had a promise that it wouldn't die was humanity. When it comes to the second issue you raise, how is this good? Well, there is still good to life forms, even if they ultimately die. Life is itself a good. So if you're, let's say, a brontosaurus, since you mentioned dinosaurs, you know, brontosaurus is a plant eater. So it eats plants, and it gets life, and that's good for the brontosaurus. But if a tyrannosaurus then comes along and eats the brontosaurus, that sustains the tyrannosaur's life, which is good for the tyrannosaur. So there's still good going on here. If you look in the Catechism's discussion of this subject, it talks about how God created the world in a state of journeying. That's the phrase it uses, with the appearance of new life forms and the disappearance of other life forms, and that state of journeying, it's referring here to evolution, it says that state of journeying will continue until the universe reaches its final form. And so, you know, there is good in the universe, even when there's death. In fact, humans die these days because of the fall. Humans die, but it's still good to be alive, and God still gives us good, both in this life and in the afterlife. Now, a common opinion, this is not church teaching, but a common opinion historically has been that animals don't have afterlives. But that's just an opinion. It's not church teaching. And I actually did a look at the question of animal afterlife, considering the arguments both against it and for it. I found the arguments against it unconvincing, and I found that we actually have some evidence that at least some animals may have an afterlife. That's an episode of Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World, and you can check that out. It is episode 203, so you could go to mysterious.fm/203 and watch or listen to that episode. And if animals have an afterlife, then they're just like us in terms of death. Death is just a temporary blip, and God can continue to do good things for them in the next life.
Nicholas, it's time for our break, so I will say thank you, and we'll let you go. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin on Catholic Answers Live.
We're here for you. Call now. Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
One of the reasons we should go to Mass is because it is the food of the saints that we receive. And for the saints, they understood rightly that the time after Holy Communion, that those moments are the most precious moments of our lives.
The Holy Sacrifice of the Mass, live from the EWTN Chapel, every morning, 8 Eastern, on EWTN Radio and Television.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin is our guest this hour. It's Open Forum. The number is 888-31-TRUTH. And where are we going right now? I guess we'll go to Rachel in Indiana watching on YouTube. Rachel, thank you for the call. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Well, I want to thank you very much for Mysterious World first.
thank you.
Enjoy listening. I am a teacher currently doing a Bible as a story unit with my junior high kids, and mm-hmm. they have a lot of questions. So we mm-hmm. voted on which one we wanted to send to you.
Okay.
The top question, almost unanimous, did Adam and Eve's kids have to have kids with their siblings?
Okay. Well, there are different opinions on this. And I'll tell you the common historic opinion first. The common historic opinion is that, yes, they did have to have kids with their own brothers and sisters because that's all the people there were. It started with just Adam and Eve, nobody else. And everyone else is a direct descendant from them with no other input. So there weren't any other people for Adam and Eve's children to marry except each other. Marry your brother or marry your sister. I was recently reading a book from the Second Temple period. This is the period in history that's around the time of Jesus. And this book is not in the Bible. So this is not a canonical book. It's not reliable the way the Bible is. But it's a book called the Book of Jubilees. And it's essentially a rewritten version of Genesis. And it's interesting because even though it's not part of the Bible and is not authoritative, it contains ideas that were circulating among Jewish people around Jesus's time. This book was written about, 150 years before Jesus. And so it reflects the opinions of at least some Jews in this period. And one of the fascinating things when you read the Book of Jubilees is it not only talks about Adam and Eve as the first humans, and it mentions, the names of some of their children like Cain and Abel and Seth, it also names their sisters. And it talks about who married who. And in the understanding of the author of the Book of Jubilees, who is not a biblical author, he's kind of speculating on all this stuff. He talks about which son of Adam married which daughter of Adam and stuff like that. So this was an opinion that was out there in this historical period, and it subsequently became a very common opinion in Christian history. And so through most of Christian history, most theologians and biblical scholars would say, yep, they married their own siblings because they were the only people. And we're not supposed to marry our siblings today, but it was okay for them to do it because they needed to get the human race started. And that overcame the problems that marrying your brother and sister normally have. There are problems. And today we understand them even better than they did back then, because now we know about genetics. And we know that if you marry a very close relative, like a brother or sister, then your children may well have genetic damage. Because if you have a chromosome in your family that is that causes a problem, and then you marry someone in your family, there's a high chance that both of you might have that problem chromosome. And if the child gets two copies of that problem chromosome, it can cause genetic damage and genetic diseases for the child. And so it can be very bad. Just because of genetics. There are other reasons why it's bad too. But the argument that theologians like St. Thomas Aquinas, now he didn't know about genetics, but the argument that St. Thomas Aquinas and others would make is, yeah, there are bad things if you marry a close relative like this, so we shouldn't do it today because we don't need to. But in the first few generations, it was the only choice. And they needed to get the human race going because God told them be fruitful and multiply. So they needed to do it back then, even though it later became unnecessary and today is even wrong to do. So that's the common historical opinion. This opinion assumes that Adam and Eve were the only two people in existence. But these days, the church has shown some flexibility to other possibilities, like maybe Adam and Eve were two individuals that were part of a larger population of people who are sometimes called pre-Adamites. And if there were pre-Adamites, then there would be other people for Adam and Eve to marry, for Adam and Eve's children to marry. Also, another option that's been proposed that the church has displayed some openness to is the idea that Adam and Eve, whose names mean man, like mankind and life, that they actually are symbols that represent the entire a larger early human community. And in that case, there would be additional people for the first humans to marry because they were part of a larger group. They wouldn't have to marry their literal brothers and sisters. So those are more recent opinions that have been proposed that the church has shown some flexibility towards. But as I said, the historic understanding, the most common one historically, is that, yeah, they had to marry their own siblings because they were the only ones to marry.
Okay, Rachel.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. You teach in a Catholic school, or is it like a...
Yes, I do.
Oh, you do. Well, I'll tell you what. I'd like to send you a copy of Jimmy Akin's book, A Daily Defense, 365 Days Plus One to Becoming a Better Apologist. If you hang on, I'll send it to you. I think the kids will very much like having it in the classroom to get to check things out. Let's see. We can go on then. Rachel, thank you again for the call. Let's go to Brecken in Cincinnati, Ohio, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Brecken, thanks for downloading our app onto your phone. Go ahead with your question.
Hey, I wanted to ask Jimmy about the cyclical universe model, because I've been seeing stuff online of the scientists saying like they basically proved it. The Big Bang is it's not the big theory anymore, and that the universe is eternal. It's just been expanding and contracting and expanding and contracting, and that's really been making me struggle with my faith, because if the I'm just having lots of problems with the theory and if it disproves God or not.
Okay, well, let's take before I respond to the does it disprove God argument, who on earth are you hearing that's advocating a cyclical model saying it's been proved? I don't know any scientists who claim that. No one has claimed it's been proved ever, so far as I know. The Big Bang has become it currently is the standard cosmological model for how the universe came into existence. Now, there is speculation about, you know, something existing before the Big Bang, but that's not the same as a cyclical universe where you have the universe expand and then reach a limit and then contract and then expand again. That's the cyclical model, where it just keeps on expanding and contracting forever. That was a proposed explanation before the 1990s, but in the 19, and the question was, does the universe have enough mass in it to slow its expansion to a stop and then reverse it and contract again? Because, you know, with the Big Bang, the universe is flying out, and if it's going to stop, something needs to stop it, and that would be gravity. And gravity is caused by mass. So the question was, is there enough mass in the universe to slow the expansion of the Big Bang and reverse it so it collapses back in on itself? And even if it did, that wouldn't mean it would explode again. So this was only a proposal. The cyclical model was a proposal. But then in the 1990s, we were able to map the cosmic microwave background in such a way that we got readings, and I won't go into all the details, but we were able to get measurements that indicated the universe is not slowing down. It's actually speeding up. It's flying apart faster and faster. And so the cyclical model took a big blow because there is no mechanism that we know of to make the universe stop and reverse itself. It looks like the opposite would happen. It would fly apart forever. There have been some, a very few cosmologists or scientists who have tried to propose a model that would allow something like something kind of like the cyclical model. The British scientist Roger Penrose, for example, has proposed that when the universe gets to a certain point of expansion, it kind of loses its identity and then continues expanding in something that looks like a new Big Bang. And so it doesn't collapse on this model. It just kind of goes through a transformation that results in a series of Big Bangs. But and Penrose has claimed to see some evidence for that in the cosmic microwave background. But other scientists have looked at it and said, nah, Penrose is wrong on this. In fact, Penrose has a history of proposing some kind of wild things. And most cosmologists have looked at Penrose's proposal and said he just doesn't have the evidence for his proposal here. This is another one of Penrose's very creative but nonetheless wild ideas that is not supported by the evidence. So I'm unaware of anyone, claiming the cyclical model has been proved. So that's the first thing I'd say to reassure you. Certainly, it is not the dominant opinion. The dominant opinion is that the Big Bang happened. Whether there was or was not something before the Big Bang is a debatable issue. But the second point I'd make to reassure you, and I'll have to go into this in more detail on the other side of the break, but the second thing I'd say is, even if there was something before the Big Bang, that doesn't disprove the existence of God. In fact, even if the cyclical model were true, it would not disprove the existence of God, and I'll explain why on the other side of the break.
Hang on, if you would. We'll take a very quick break and be right back with more Open Forum. Lots of calls, so no lines open at the moment, but you can keep trying. As they open up, you might get in. 888-318-7884. Why We're Catholic is the one book you can hand to anyone to invite them into or back to the Catholic faith. With more than 400,000 copies sold, Trent Horn's book has had a number one ranking on Amazon.com for 5 years running. Now available in softcover, bulk cases, ebook, and on Audible. Find out what the excitement is all about. Order your copies of Why We're Catholic at shop.catholic.com or at a good Catholic bookstore. Visit whyweirecatholic.com.
If you're not a Bible scholar, the full message of how the Sunday Mass readings fit together can be tough to comprehend. Apologist Carlo Broussard is here to help. Join Carlo every Friday for the Sunday Catholic Word Podcast. In each episode, he unpacks the scripture readings for that Sunday and brings them all together so you can better understand and defend the faith. Visit SundayCatholicWord.com to subscribe. That's SundayCatholicWord.com.
Is Orthodoxy an alternative to the Catholic Church? In a time of uncertainty for many Catholics, Orthodoxy can look like greener pastures. Answering Orthodoxy, the new book from Catholic Answers Press, explains why Catholics who are thinking of leaving need to think twice. There are important reasons to remain in the Catholic Church and convincing answers to Orthodox claims. Order your copy of Answering Orthodoxy today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to casociety315.com and join today.
A beacon is a light, and we'll shine it on God's Word. I'm Deacon Harold Burke Sivers, and I invite you to join me tomorrow for Beacon of Truth on most of these EWTN stations. Now back to Catholic Answers Live with Cy Kellett.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. A little bit of groovy music there for you. Hey, it's no joke. Catholic Answers Shop is holding an April Fool's Week sale. You'll want to check out everything in our online shop is on sale. Books, digital products, online courses, gift items, and more. But wait, there's more. We've got just a week left for our 20 Answers $2 book sale, 100 titles to choose from. And wait, there's even more than that. If you live in the continental U.S., we're giving you free shipping on orders over $50. Free shipping in the continental U.S. What are you waiting for? Get yourself over to shop.catholic.com and load up on some great Catholic resources and let the savings begin. Open Forum here. Jimmy Akin is our guest. We were, I believe it was Brecken you were talking to about whether a cyclical universe would disprove the existence of God.
Yeah. So the answer is it wouldn't, because you still got to explain why there's a universe at all. You know, things need explanations, and the Christian faith does not rest, the belief in God does not rest on what's known as the Kalam cosmological argument. The Kalam argument is the one that proceeds from the universe having a beginning. The argument in short form goes, anything that has a beginning has a cause. The universe has a beginning, therefore the universe must have a cause, and then that cause would be God. And that's a an argument for God's existence, but it's not the only one. In fact, the Kalam argument historically has not been particularly well favored. There have been attempts to, the key is how do you prove the universe had a beginning? And science suggests it had a beginning, but the results of science are always provisional. In the past, before the scientific revolution, people would sometimes try to argue on philosophical grounds that the universe had to have a beginning. And some individuals like Saint Bonaventure, who is a doctor of the church, thought that they could argue that the universe had to have a beginning philosophically. Others, like St. Thomas Aquinas, who's also a doctor of the church, looked at those arguments and said, yeah, they're not conclusive. And even though I'm not a Thomist, I agree with Thomas Aquinas on this one. I don't think the philosophical arguments at all show that the universe had to have a beginning. If God is omnipotent, and so he can do anything that doesn't involve a logical contradiction, and consequently, I don't see any logical contradiction in the idea of the universe having an infinite history. We know the universe is going to have an infinite future. So if it can have an infinite future, if God can create that, then God can also create an infinite past for the universe. So I don't think the philosophical defense of the Kalam argument works. But that's just one argument. There are lots of others that don't presuppose anything about the universe having a beginning. One of my favorites is the contingency argument. And this one begins by noting that some things in the universe are contingent, meaning they could be otherwise. Like, I weigh a certain amount, but I could weigh a different amount. You know, I could go to the moon and I'd weigh about a sixth of what I weigh here on Earth. I could go to Mars and it'd be more than a sixth, but not anywhere near close to what I weigh here on Earth. I could lose weight. I could gain weight. So my weight is contingent. It could be different than it is. Well, anytime you have a contingent thing, you can ask, why is it the way it is? And you could appeal to its history to explain that, but that's not the most interesting question. Without talking about its history, you could say, why is it the way it is right now, even if it didn't have a history? Why is it the way it is right now? Like, why do I weigh the amount I weigh right now here on Earth? Well, to explain that, you could talk about the mass of the molecules in my body and the strength of the Earth's gravitational field, and you could calculate my weight from that. Okay, so fine. One of the things you just appealed to is the law of gravity. Okay, why is there a law of gravity? Because that could have a different value than it does. You know, why we have a gravitational constant, but why is that constant what it is? And so anytime you have a contingent thing, something that could be different, you can say, why is it the way it is? And you may be able to come up with an answer, but you can't just keep proposing answers infinitely, because then that wouldn't explain anything. Ultimately, you need to ground the explanation of all the contingent things in the universe in something that's necessary, in something that's God. And so even if the universe had an infinite history, like a cyclical history, that wouldn't disprove God at all, because you need to explain, why is there a universe rather than there not being a universe? Why is there something rather than nothing? And ultimately, God is the best explanation. And so even if the universe had a cyclical history that stretched back indefinitely, that wouldn't at all disprove God. And as I pointed out before the break, the idea that the universe has a cyclical history is an idea that's been talked about, but it is very far from having been proved. And the fact is, we can't see anything before the Big Bang. As far as the current scientific evidence indicates, the Big Bang was the beginning. And even if it wasn't, the faith would tell us, well, the beginning was just further back. But nobody has proved remotely that the universe has an infinite history.
Brecken, does that all help you? Not so sure.
Oh,
Well, you know, we may have a bad, I don't know about, I have the line open, but the connection may not still be good. I don't know, because I put him on hold and brought him back. But Brecken, we'll just say thanks. Thanks for the call. I hope that that was helpful to you. We'll go to Bellevue, Nebraska. Ricky's in Bellevue, Nebraska, listening on our website, catholic.com. Ricky, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hey, guys. Thanks for taking my call. Unfortunately, we'll be able to stick around for your answer, Jimmy, so I'll have to listen to it tomorrow. But I'd still like to ask my question. I was just curious. Actually, I'm calling on behalf of my wife. She wanted me to ask you this. On Good Friday, my wife and I, we experienced our first miscarriage.
Aww.
And we were just curious, what is the Catholic kind of teaching on, not so much miscarriage, but on, like, the idea of continual miscarriages and having a family, just because, you know, it's difficult emotionally and spiritually, and can be difficult physically too, even with enough. And although it was our first one, you know, we're aware that, you know, more could happen as well. So we just didn't know. My wife in particular was just curious what the Catholic Church teaches on that, because I know the Catholic Church is against, you know, ideas of like vasectomies and things like that. So I just didn't know if it was okay. kind of like a judgment on like natural family planning. If that
I
makes
got
sense.
The question, Kent. Why don't I take a stab at it? So the answer is the church does not have any teaching about whether you should or should not continue attempting to have children in a situation where you know they're likely to miscarry. The church has never said don't do that. But it doesn't have a and it's never said you must do that. So since there's not a church teaching on this, we have to fall back on the principles of Catholic moral theology to figure out what we should do. And I would point out that even if a child dies, that child still is a new eternal being. You've brought, even if the child dies before birth or at birth or even a little bit after birth, you still brought a new eternal being into the world. And that's a good. People are good. You know, at the end of Genesis 1, once God had made people, he said, now creation's very good. And so it's very good to bring new people into the world, even if their earthly life is going to be very short, because they will continue to exist after their death on earth. Eventually, they'll be resurrected and they'll have eternal life, just like the rest of us. And, you know, since they haven't committed any personal sins, they're going to be, in the opinion of many theologians, they're going to be with God. They're going to have a blessed existence. And so you're bringing in someone brand new who's very likely to be with God and who's going to be there forever. This is awesome. And so it's certainly not wrong to keep bringing new eternal beings into the world, even if you know their earthly life will be very short, maybe just a few months and maybe ending before they were physically born. On the other hand, God also recognizes that it can be difficult emotionally and in other ways to keep doing this. And so you're not required to keep having as many children as possible. The church acknowledges that families can make prudent decisions based on their circumstances about the number of children that they can have. And they just need to, if they determine we need to, you know, not have children for now, then they just need to use the appropriate means of that, which is not a vasectomy and it's not other forms of artificial birth control, but you can use natural family planning to say, okay, we've reached the limit of what's reasonable, either in terms of the number of children that we've had who have been born or the number of children we've had who have miscarried, and say, okay, now we're going to use natural family planning for the time being. And if in the future we decide our situation is different, then we can go ahead and do that too. I also would encourage you, since you said this is the first miscarriage, I want to encourage everybody to pray for you and for your family and for everybody else who's had miscarriages. But I would encourage you to be of good heart, because lots of people have miscarriages. In fact, between 30 and 50% of pregnancies miscarry before the parents even know that the woman is pregnant. So miscarriages are very common, but that means there's lots of new eternal beings for us to meet in heaven who we gave rise to. And you know, if you've only had one miscarriage so far, well, one data point does not set a pattern. So I would encourage you to, you know, get the medical advice you need, but be of good courage about having other children, and don't worry about it if you have miscarriages, because those are still just more children you'll get to meet in heaven.
Ricky, thank you very much. We've got to take a quick break. Right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin on Catholic Answers Live.
Hello, this is Archbishop Salvatore Cordiglione of San Francisco. Keep your dial tuned to Catholic Answers Live.
In Morse code, the sequence SOS is a distress call. It's been said that it stands for Save Our Souls. Well, right now our world is in big trouble, and we're putting out an SOS call for help. Will you answer that call? St. Paul Street Evangelization, a Catholic nonprofit, has hundreds of teams who share the good news with souls who don't know Jesus. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. Visit streetevangelization.com to get involved.
Some special items on EWTNRC.com this month are these personalized First Communion gifts. Whether you're looking for a wall cross, holy water font, desk shrine, or arched plaque, each of these EWTN exclusive items can be personalized to commemorate this special occasion in the life of every Catholic. To order, go to EWTNRC.com and search FC 2024 to see the full collection.
Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin, our guest this hour. Next hour, Tim Staples, and it is open forum. You are welcome to call with whatever question you have. 888-318-7884. Going to Champaign, Illinois, where Kent is listening on Holy Family Radio. Kent, thank you for the call. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Good day to both of you. I have a question about whether or not Catholic theology distinguishes between a person's spirit and a person's soul?
In the main, no. This is something that the Catechism of the Catholic Church talks about. It acknowledges that there are two fundamental components in a human being. There's our body, and then, which is a physical component, but then there's also a second non-physical component, which can be called either our spirit or our soul. Now, that doesn't mean that the terms soul and spirit are pure synonyms and that they don't have ever any shades of difference between them. It's kind of like, you know, I have one physical body, but I have different aspects to that physical body. Like my stomach is not the same thing as my head. And so, you know, they're both part of my body, but they're both part of the physical side of me, but they have different meanings. If I say my stomach hurts versus my head hurts. And there are some passages in Scripture where the terms spirit and soul are used as if they're just synonyms, as if they mean exactly the same thing. But there are also passages where they're used in different ways. And so they can have some differences between them, but they both refer together to the invisible, immaterial part of us. So there's a visible part of us that's physical, that we can use a collective term of body for, but we can also use subterms like head and stomach and so forth. And then there's also an invisible, immaterial part of us, which we can call a soul or a spirit, but we can also use those terms in other ways too. Fundamentally, mankind has two parts: the physical part and the non-physical immaterial part.
I sometimes think of the spirit as the totally immaterial creation of a human being that God does, and the soul as the image of that spirit in the material world.
Well, you know, people, terms mean what people use them to mean. So if that's how you use those terms, then that's what they mean when you're using them that way. Having said that, you know, I don't know that the Bible uses them that way. It does sometimes use the word spirit, to refer to the immaterial part of a person, but I'm unaware of any biblical text that would use the term soul as a physical representation or image of the spirit.
Kent, thank you. It's open forum. Jimmy Akin, our guest, and we're going to New York, where Patrick is watching on Facebook. This is our good friend Patrick, I bet. Is it you, Patrick?
Yes, it is.
Oh, I'm so happy to get to talk with you again. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Sure. I do a parish Bible study, and one of the things I do to prepare is look at other Bible studies. And I came up with a real puzzle. In some of the Bible studies, they say the word Hosanna, the word we say on Palm Sunday, means praise and glory. Makes sense to me. Other Bible studies say that Hosanna means deliver us, rescue me, which also makes sense in the context of it being Palm Sunday. What is the correct definition, or are they both correct, or is there more context needed?
So the first one you said was, what was it again?
Praise and glory.
Okay. So there's a discussion in biblical scholarship about exactly what the term Hosanna means. It's an Aramaic word that comes from Hebrew roots, and the main component of it, the part that gives us the Hosan, the part, is, or the Hosa part, is basically a form of the Hebrew verb for save, which can be translated other ways like rescue and things like that. But basically it means save. Then it's also the root of the name Jesus. You know, his name means, you know, salvation. Then the na part of it on the end is a part, it's what's known as a particle. In linguistics, a particle is a small word that does not change its form. And this particle is basically a politeness marker. It's like please in English or po in Tagalog. So if you want to, if you have a request in Tagalog, you'll say your request and then you'll say po to make it polite. In English, if you have a request like pass the salt, you don't just use the command form, the imperative, pass the salt. You say the request, but then you add the politeness particle, please, pass the salt, please. And that's basically what na does. So if you say Hosanna, based on its etymology, it means save, please, or something to that effect, rescue, please. Now, this term got used in Jewish liturgy. And in particular, there was a particular day during one of the Jewish feasts that was known as Hosanna Day, because as they were doing the ceremony, people would shout Hosanna. And from that, some biblical scholars thought that the term may have acquired a new meaning, because terms do that over time. They acquire new meanings, they shift in meaning, and they thought maybe this has become a cry of celebration. So it means something like hooray or or glory to God or something like that. However, the most recent scholarship I've seen casts doubt on that. The last time I revisited this issue, I saw references to, you know, biblical scholars questioning that interpretation, and in making a personal assessment, while I didn't spend a huge amount of time on it, I said, you know, I don't think I have confidence in that claim. So I tend to think that we don't, at least based on my present state of information, I don't think we have good evidence that it shifted meaning to mean something like hooray or glory to God. It looks to me like it probably did keep its original meaning of save, please. And so that would be how I would translate it absent further study.
Okay. Well, Patrick, thank you. It's nice talking with you.
September can't come too soon for me.
Oh, we'll see. You're talking about the conference. I'm glad you're coming. We look forward to seeing you. We just look forward to that conference every year. And thanks for saying it, because I know you want me to say CatholicAnswersConference.com. That's where people can find out all about the big conference, about the teachings and sayings of Jesus, CatholicAnswersConference.com. Thank you, Patrick. Patrick's does all kinds of work as a catechist and evangelist there in New York. And on we go now to Brianna in Missouri, listening on the Covenant Radio Network. Brianna, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, yes. I'm a convert, and I've been in the church for about 5 years. My husband's a cradle Catholic, and recently my mother has decided that she's pagan. Growing up, we were raised in the Mormon church. I was an LDS for most of my life until I went to college, and she's been a little bit confrontational, it seems like, lately. Especially, she acts like she wants to have a conversation about things. In particular, today, my question is regarding St. Patrick. So she, and how I should kind of bring this conversation up with her, or try to combat it without being confrontational. So she was talking about the pagans and with St. Patrick and the, like, getting rid of the snakes in Ireland, but she said that the snakes are a metaphor for the pagans, and that St. Patrick was sent by the Catholic Church to force conversion, and that the running out of the snakes is actually him running the pagans out, and that the church and St. Patrick in particular were very violent in crucifying and throwing women and children off of a mountain. I don't think that those things are true, but she's sending me all these different like sources and things like that. And then I try to send her sources, but her sources are pagan and my sources are Catholic. And so I just am at that point of, I don't know how to have a good relationship with her.
Well, let's let Jimmy answer just because we're getting near the end here, Brianna. I got to let Jimmy take a shot at an answer for you.
Okay, so the first thing I'd say, and I'd love to have more time to discuss this, but the first thing I'd say is that the whole snake thing is, as far as I'm aware, it has a completely different origin. As far as I'm aware, there just aren't any snakes that are native to Ireland, and there may have been some at one time, but they didn't survive, and so there are no snakes now, and people wondered, you know, well, why is that? Why does Ireland not have snakes? And as a kind of folk explanation, people said, oh, St. Patrick must have done it. You know, since the snake is a symbol of the devil and St. Patrick was a great saint, maybe he drove all the snakes out of Ireland. But that's just a folk explanation. That's not something the church teaches. So I don't take this St. Patrick snake thing seriously. I haven't looked into, is it technically true that there are no snakes in Ireland? But I'm very sure that the legend of St. Patrick driving them out is just a pious story. It's not historically accurate. We do have information about St. Patrick's life, and none of the historically accurate information would suggest that. We do actually have a couple of writings of St. Patrick. We have his own conversion story. We have a letter that he wrote to a local pagan who was persecuting Christians. You could get a copy of St. Patrick's writings and read them for yourself and, you know, and give them to your mom. And he's not forcibly converting anybody. Now, if you have a sort of source war going on with her quoting pagan sources and you quoting Catholic sources, well, those aren't the only sources we have. How about looking at academic sources that don't presuppose either a pagan or a Catholic point of view? If you do that, I'm real sure you're going to find out that St. Patrick did not oversee forced conversions. That's not to say forced conversions have never happened, but But then the reverse has happened too, where pagans have used forced conversions on Christians. That's what the early martyrdom in the church was all about, was when Christians resisted the force being used to convert them to paganism. So nobody here can claim to have pure hands historically. And I would suggest pointing those things out to your mom and saying, let's lower the temperature and just continue to love each other. And maybe we'll discuss things in the future religiously, but we shouldn't be trying to religiously bash each other.
Brianna, thank you for the call and for the question. Hey, if you're on the line, hang on the line. We're going to continue with Open Forum with Tim Staples after just a couple minutes break. Jimmy, thank you very much. Enjoyed the time.
My pleasure.
All right, right back with more Open Forum on Catholic Answers Live. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Open forum. Jimmy Akin, first hour. Tim Staples, second hour. And we're not even raising money. It's an amazing day here at Catholic Answers. You're welcome to call, but I'll tell you right now, at the moment, the lines are full. But give it a try as the hour progresses, and we'll try to get we'll do our best, anyways, to get you on with Tim Staples. 888-318-7884. It's open forum. Open forum means open to you, wherever you are, whatever your question is. You want to know something about the Bible, about Jesus, about the Catholic faith, about the popes, about the moral teachings of the church, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884, 888-31-TRUTH. Tim Staples, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers, the author of Behold Your Mother, A Biblical and Historical Defense of the Marian Doctrines. Hello, Tim Staples.
Hello, Cy Kellett.
Is it an illusion, or are you not traveling as much these days?
No, like, I haven't been. Ever since. I don't think I've ever gotten back up to full swing yet since my stroke.
Oh, yeah. But like in the fall and winter, I think you were away a bit, but I was.
I had an explosion there. I've kind of slowed things down to where I'm only going out on average once a month.
Oh, slowed it down to once a month, huh?
I used to do 3 times a month.
That's wild.
But my body and my brain will not allow me to do that any longer. So
I've asked you this before, but yeah. Have you ever done the thing where you wake up and you don't remember for a few minutes where you are?
Yes.
Like, what city am I in?
I have done the thing like you see in commercials where I stand up in front of an audience.
Oh,
and
I know what you're going
to
say.
I have forgotten where I am. Back when I used to
nice
really.
Nice to see you, Cleveland.
Oh
man, yeah. This is Baton
Hello,
Rouge.
Hello, Cleveland. You're in Louisiana, you know. No, I really have had that happen back when I would do, you know, lots of those trips back to back to backers.
Yeah.
You know, it was crazy. Yeah. But yeah, you know, I listen to the doctors, you know, and say, look, yeah. You know, you got to challenge yourself, but at the same time, you don't want to do too much. So that's
right.
Where we're at.
Right. Hey, the number is 888-318-7884. It's an open forum, and whatever you ask right now, it's coming right out of Tim's head. He's got his computer is not working. They just took it away from him. So what?
I feel naked with no computer here.
You're getting the straight Tim answer. Cassandra in Atlanta, Georgia, watching on YouTube. You're first up this hour. Thank you for the call, Cassandra. Go ahead with your question.
Thanks for taking my call. So the Old Testament can make God appear. He can appear to many as angry, mean, or jealous God. However, the New Testament describes him as kind, forgiving, and a loving God. There's a famous motivational speaker, Tony Robbins, and he's also Christian, commented on this, and he came to the conclusion that it's because God grows. What
Ouch.
Is the Catholic answer to this question? Doesn't God know everything before it even happens? Does this mean God can change his mind and grow?
Right. Great question. And the answer is no, it is metaphysically impossible, absurd to say that God could grow, because God is, by definition, pure actuality. There can be no potency in him. If a creature has potency, that means he ain't God. God is pure actuality, meaning he cannot come to learn anything because he already knows it. I say this often, you know, I've said this to my kids, and I think they've got it, Cy. I do. I say, God can't move from here to there. Why? Because he's already there, mm-hmm. Right? He's omnipresent, omniscient, omnipotent, all right? So, no, God cannot grow. It is we. So I look at the differences between Old and New Testament. Number one, I would say they are overblown, because it is the same God in both Testaments, to be sure, because, yes, we see judgment fall on Sodom and Gomorrah, and we see the 10 plagues. We could go through a litany of things in the Old Testament, but we also see, hey, my computer just appeared and it works. All right. But we also see the tender and kindness of God in the Old Testament. Just look at Psalm 118 and Psalm 136. His mercy endures forever. His love endures forever. His love is everlasting, right? His mercy toward his people is so prevalent and evident in the Old Testament. Now, we go to the New Testament and we see Ananias and Sapphira, right? Whom God killed on the spot for withholding part of what they promised to give there shortly after Pentecost. You know, and we have the Jesus who dies on the cross also puts his finger in the face of the Pharisees in John 8:44 and says, "You are of your father the devil. He was a liar from the beginning, and you are liars." And on we could go. So I believe it's the same God. But there is a difference, to be sure, between the way God treats his people, not because of a change in God, but I like to look at it the way St. Irenaeus, when he was dealing with Marcion, you know, the Gnostic heretic who also fell prey to the same error of Mr. Robbins there in thinking because of the differences between the old and the new, there were, he actually said two gods, not that God grew, but there's actually two gods, sort of a good God and a bad God, or a God and a demigod, that sort of demiurge sort of thing. And St. Irenaeus, way back in the second century, said, no, it's not God who's changed, it's man who has changed. And so God, St. Irenaeus looked at it kind of like the way I look at it with dealing with my children. I've got seven of them, and they range from 20 down to seven. I do not treat my 18-year-old and my 20-year-old the same way that I would treat my 7-year-old or my 9-year-old. If I did, we would have some serious problems, right? Mm-hmm. Because they are very different. You treat them very different. And so God is, if you view him as a father, because that's what he is, he's revealed as a father to his people. The ancient people in Old Testament times, he dealt with very differently because they were an ancient people, a barbaric people as well, tribal and such. He dealt with them very different, but he gave graces to his people over time, and he elevates the conversation, giving them the law. And when it comes to the law and the prophets, we see a development over the centuries until by the time Christ comes, as Galatians 4:4 says, when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law. And that's why Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 would say that God, who in various and partial way, a form of the Greek word meridus there, God who in various and partial ways spoke by the prophets in these last days has spoken by his son. Right? So he gives the definitive word that he only gave partially to the ancient people. He gives the definitive word to his son. So there's the sort of the reason for the difference. It's not a change in God, it's a change in man. Does that make sense?
Yeah, actually, that makes a lot of sense. Thank you so much.
God bless you, Cassandra.
Thank you, Cassandra. Thank you very much. We'll take a break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Tim Staples on Catholic Answers Live.
Let us help you with your question today on Catholic Answers Live.
Do you have a question but prefer to ask it privately? Catholic Questions can help. Go to CatholicQuestions.com to ask your question online, email us, drop us a letter, or give us a call. Longtime Catholic Answers Live apologist and author Jim Blackburn or another Catholic Questions apologist will be happy to assist you. Catholic Questions proudly supports Catholic Answers Live, so visit us at CatholicQuestions.com today. That's CatholicQuestions.com.
Each weekday, we'll dive into the timeless teachings of our Catholic faith, drawing upon the wisdom of the ages to navigate the challenges of today. Together, we'll seek truth, find inspiration, and forge a deeper connection with God. I'm Deacon Harold Burke Sivers, and I invite you to join me for Beacon of Truth, tomorrow at 4 p.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Tim Staples is our guest, and it's open forum. You are welcome to call 888-318-7884. We'll go to Augusta, Georgia. We're just in Atlanta, Georgia with Cassandra, now with Daniel in Augusta, Georgia, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Thanks for downloading our app onto your phone, Daniel. Go ahead with your question for Tim.
Hi, how you doing? Can you hear me?
Pretty well. Try to be as close as you can to the phone because it sounds a little bit distant.
Okay, hold on. Let me go to speaker.
Are you going to speaker? Oh, that sounds
good.
I
had a question about the rosary.
Okay.
And Mary, I was reading it, and it said Mary made 15 promises to those who recite it devoutly and, I guess, daily.
Okay.
And one of the promises I was curious, she said that she will deliver those who recite her rosary from purgatory.
Yeah.
And I was wondering if we recite it daily and devoutly, will we be able to, like, skip purgatory?
Yes. Great question, and absolutely. But the key is devoutly. And what does that mean? In fact, you could exercise any of the devotions of our Catholic faith. And if you do so devoutly, and by devoutly, that means to the point where you are completely free from all detachment to sin, both mortal and venial, and you receive the sacraments well, which all sacramentals and private revelations in the church, remember, including the rosary, are ordered toward our reception of our blessed Lord well in the Eucharist. Everything in our faith, right, Cy, is ordered to the Eucharist,
amen. Yes.
Which is Jesus Christ himself. So if you are truly praying Divine Mercy Chaplet devoutly to the point where you are free of all detachment, both mortal and venial sin, and you are receiving the sacraments regularly, you will, in fact, skip purgatory. I like that, skip purgatory.
Yeah.
Because, you know, that's a good way to put it, because you are. You would go immediately to heaven. Now, the doing of it, that's the difficult part, because being perfectly, you know, detached from all sin, both mortal and venial, is not exactly easy. But remember, Jesus never said it was going to be easy. He told us in Matthew 5:48, be ye perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Right? Is that easy? No. Wide, he says in Matthew 7:13, wide and spacious is the way that leads to destruction, and there will be many therein. Narrow is the way that leads to eternal life, and few find it. So, no, it's not easy, but it's certainly possible. And with not just the rosary, which has a track record as one of the greatest private devotions the church has ever produced, and of course, it's because it's produced from on high. It's not just the church producing that, but our Blessed Mother gave it to us as a gift. You're talking about all these gifts. If we use them well, they will attain their end in us, and that is going directly to heaven. And you know, Daniel, it's a great and important question, because we have to remember, don't we, Cy, that we're not made for purgatory.
No, right.
We are made for heaven. Jesus didn't die on the cross so we can go to purgatory. Now, it's a fact that we will go to purgatory if, in fact, we die in a state of grace and we still have sins, you know, venial sins on our souls and or punishment due for forgiven sins. But that's not our end. That is not why Jesus died on the cross for us. He died on the cross so that we could go to heaven and that we could be free from sin. And that's what our Blessed Mother is saying. The rosary is all about giving us the power to be free from sin.
Thanks, Daniel. I'm going to keep going because we've got lots of folks on the line. Jacob in Katy, Texas, watching on YouTube. Jacob, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Tim.
All right. Is it all right if I have two questions?
It is, but you can only give us one.
One
no,
at
I'm only
a time.
Kidding. I'm only kidding.
No, he meant one at a time.
We'll see. We'll okay. see, Jacob. Right. Just behave yourself right. and we'll see.
That sounds great.
Okay.
So my first question is, so just for some backstory really quickly. So at my high school, there's like, I kind of have the opportunity to talk to like a lot of kids in my class.
Yeah.
What I've started doing is I've started making rosaries and I've handed them out. And that's led me to be able to like talk to a bunch of these kids
Great.
About their faith. And I've been able to answer a lot of their questions, but
wow.
I feel like the seeds are kind of superficial. Okay. Or like if I hand out a rosary, I feel like it's not bringing fruit. So how do you recommend I kind of like get through to these people to help them understand like Catholicism, I guess, or how have like a meaningful conversation with them?
Is this a public school?
Oh, yes, sir.
Wow. Well,
you can
tell
ask all the questions you want, Jacob.
Yeah, that's right. I have to say, first and foremost, man, I would not say that, like, wow, this isn't enough. I feel like, no, what you are doing is extraordinary. I'm surprised you haven't gotten into trouble for handing out rosaries in a public school. I mean, that is a huge blessing and a bold statement of your Catholic faith, brother, and you are to be commended for that, because I'll guarantee you may think that it's not having an effect, but it will, and it is having an effect, because you've got our Blessed Mother behind you. She's got your back, and I will guarantee you it will bear fruit. So seeds are being planted, brother. That's a very creative way of, you know, getting your foot in the door to start the conversation. So I think that's a fantastic way. Another thing you might want to do is hand out some tracts. You know, we at Catholic Answers, you know, what are we up to now in our tracts? You know, we had 120 forever, but I think we've added to those. I don't even know how many tracts we have.
I don't know, but you got to print them now. We just have the PDFs of them.
Okay. So if you go to our website at Catholic.com, you can print out our tracts. I don't know, 140, I want to say. 130, 140 of them on everything you can imagine. We also have a wonderful little booklet that was originally designed just for a situation like yours called Pillar of Fire, Pillar of Truth. And that, we can get them in
yes,
bulk,
we can.
Right?
We can, yeah.
Yeah, and we can send you, if you'd like, we can send you a whole bunch of them that you can hand out. Now, that may be even more effective than the rosary, because this pillar is a sort of overview of the Catholic faith. It's a very well done little booklet. It's amazing what it covers in just a few short pages. So that might be something you want. And if you'd like, we can send you out a bunch of them for free. Would that help?
That sounds absolutely amazing. Because I've had to pull it up. Because I'll go to the USCCB website, and they have a how to pray the rosary. But I think just having it like in a paper format is just so much more helpful.
Oh yeah, okay. And this will be something that will answer a lot of questions that people have about the Catholic faith as well. But I just have to say again, Jacob, that you qualify. We use this word a lot in California, too much, but this you qualify for. You are awesome.
Dude, you are awesome. all right, you can go for your second question.
Second question.
All right, so my second question should be a lot easier to answer. It's what are your, I guess I'll narrow it down, five favorite books about Catholicism, or just Christianity in general, I guess.
My five favorites. That is a tough one, but I will tell you.
I can guess one, I bet.
Yes. One would be Faith of Our Fathers.
I knew it! Gibbon.
Faith of Our Fathers by James Cardinal Gibbons. It's a classic written by the late great. I guess we don't say late anymore because he's been dead for over 100 years. That's pretty late. James Cardinal Gibbons, Faith of Our Fathers, phenomenal defense of the Catholic faith from the late 19th century. Secondly, gosh, there are so many good ones, but I would say College Apologetics by Father Anthony Alexander. He was a giant in philosophy as well as theology. It's published by Tan Books, College Apologetics, and this one takes you from no faith at all the way to the Catholic faith. It is absolutely fantastic. Then there's Dr. Peter Kraft has an awesome book that he wrote together with Father Ron Tasselli, and it's called The Fundamentals of Catholic Apologetics. They had two versions of it. One was Fundamentals of Christian apologetics. I recommend the second one they did, The Fundamentals of Catholic Apologetics. Absolutely fantastic. It answers, as far as exhaustiveness goes, I think that that one takes the cake. Also, number four, a new one has been upped into my top five, and that's Why We're Catholic by our own Trent Horn. It is absolutely outstanding because it's simplicity, but yet it's very thorough in presenting, you know, basically like it says, why we are Catholic. And number five, it's kind of a tough call here. I'm thinking some classic apologetics here, but which one should I go with? I'm going to have to go with that Staples guy. You got to get Behold Your Mother.
Yep. And I think you could probably get a free copy of it.
That's right. Like, and we will. We will send you out a free copy of Behold Your Mother. And not just because I wrote it, but I do think that the Marian doctrines tend to be, at least when you're talking about inter-Christian dialogue, the biggest obstacle for so many millions of people in becoming Catholic, including myself. And so a good defense of the Marian doctrines, I guess that would be my number five out of the five.
All right, Jacob.
All right, thank you. Thank you guys so much. This is going to be so helpful.
Yeah, hang on, we'll send you the book. I want to be helpful to you in one other way, because I think there's a person who could be very helpful to you, and his name is Steve Dawson. He founded St. Paul Street Evangelization.
Oh, yeah.
And they have a series of videos and trainings on how to share Jesus with other people. And I'm going to see Steve next week, and I'm going to ask him if we can get you access to their training materials, Jacob. So shoot an email to radio@catholic.com.
And don't forget to send him out some pillars.
Oh, yeah, pillar. We'll tell, right. Yeah. You know, pillar of fire, yeah, send him some of those. And then we'll see if we can get Steve Dawson to help you out, because I think he's going to be thrilled to hear about what a fine person you are and the work you're doing there in Katy, Texas. All right, Jacob?
All right, that is amazing. Thank you so
right.
much.
All right, God bless you, brother. I mean, you're doing what we aspire to do.
Amen.
So I mean, we're happy to be in on your side as much as we can. Hang on, we're going to get information from you, and send me an email at radio@catholic.com. Emma's in Hayden, Idaho. She's watching on YouTube, and we haven't talked to her for a while. Nice to hear from you again, Emma.
Hi.
Happy Easter.
I'm actually in Happy Easter. I'm in Costa Rica, and I'm not bragging.
What'd you do? Or did you have to flee the country, Emma? Come on.
We go a couple times a year.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah, we're spoiled. I went to Sunday Mass, and it was all in Spanish, and I speak okay Spanish, and I picked out a few things. But then I got in line for communion.
Okay.
And I folded my arms across my chest, and he just looked at me. So I opened my mouth, and I wanted to get the sentence right, and he put the wafer in my mouth.
Oh, my goodness.
Okay.
What do I do?
Yeah. Well, there's...
I was mortified. I knew I couldn't spit it out.
No.
You go ahead and receive our blessed Lord and take it as a blessing from our Lord. It's not something that you...
Really?
Yes. Take it as a blessing, because that's not something that you intended. And so in a situation like that, I always think that's an example of the Holy Spirit. He is sneaky. He does stuff like that.
He is sneaky.
God just loves to bless people in ways that are surprising. Now, of course, you don't continue to do that, but take it as a blessing. And remember, you know, this is something that's quite popular in the United States, but it's not necessarily everywhere. And in fact, I've discovered as I travel around the United States, there are even some parishes that tell you not to do that. They're not very many of them. I mean, come forward and do it. I've had parishes. I don't understand it, but I remember being at a parish where they said, "Do not come forward." You know, evidently the practice had been around and such, and this particular pastor said, no, don't do that. You pray where you are and ask for God's blessing and that sort of thing. So Hey, you know, I learned something there. This was a few years back now, maybe 10, 15 years ago where that happened. But, you know, it just made me realize that, hey, the practices here in the United States are not necessarily universal, you know, and not uniform all around the world. So nothing to worry about there. And certainly, you know, it's not that that priest did anything wrong. It's probably just a different practice where he is.
Okay, Emma?
I feel so much better. You have no idea.
All right. Well,
good.
God bless you.
Go back to the beach and call us
I
when
will.
You get back to Idaho. Sorry, Emma. I put her on hold because we're going to the break. Sorry, Emma. We got to go to this break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum with Tim Staples right after this on Catholic Answers Live. When the resurrected Jesus appeared to disciples on the road to Emmaus, they didn't recognize him until the breaking of the bread. The same is true today. In the Holy Eucharist, we really meet Jesus. In The Eucharist is Really Jesus, author Joe Heschmeyer explains how knowing Jesus in the Eucharist is the key to understanding all of Christian faith. Order your copy of The Eucharist is Really Jesus today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to CASociety315.com and join today.
As we read the Gospels, every Christian faces the question again and again, what does Jesus mean? Getting the answer right is critical to both growth in holiness and fruitful evangelization. Want to know Jesus better so you can introduce him to your friends? Then it's time to get serious about understanding his words. Why not join Catholic Answers for our 10th annual Apologetics Conference? Learn from me the parables, sermons, and conversations of Jesus Christ, September 26th through 29th, right here in sunny San Diego. Learn from our guests, Dr. Scott Hahn and Kimberly Hahn, Dr. Ray Guarendi, Father Sebastian Walsh, Billy Junker, Father Paul Check, and, of course, all of your favorite Catholic Answers apologists. It'll be 4 days of fun, faith, fellowship, and a live radio show. Seats are still available, but going fast, visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 1-888-291-8000 today.
A beacon is a light and will shine it on God's word. I'm Deacon Harold Burke Sivers, and I invite you to join me tomorrow for Beacon of Truth on most of these EWTN stations. Now back to Catholic Answers Live with Cy Kellett.
Little bit of groovy music there for you on a Thursday afternoon. Thanks so much for being here with us. 888-318-7884 is the number. 888-318-7884. Annalia came in here into the studio and just told me to say this on the air. Oh, that's very helpful. So I didn't know this. At Catholic.com, we have a tract, How to Pray the Rosary. So for Jacob, who just called from Katy, Texas, if he wants to check that out, just go to Catholic.com and look in the tracks, and you'll find one on how to pray the rosary with a video. I didn't even know that we had that. So thanks, Annalia. Emma, we just talked with Emma. Keel is in Cleveland, Ohio, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Keel, thank you for the call. Go ahead with the question for Tim.
Hi, thanks, Cy.
Yes.
Tim, I spoke with you on Tuesday.
Okay.
About Sister Faustina and the Divine Mercy and just really having a hard time understanding.
Yeah, redemptive suffering. I remember that.
Yeah. So you said a lot of things that made sense.
Yes.
You did a great job of explaining the sufficiency of Christ and how that's not where you all are going.
That's right.
And you talked about the instrumental causality of priests, and then for lay people, it would be more like secondary causes.
Causality. Yes, yes. And basically, if do you want to pick up where we left off?
Since then, I've thought about other things, other ways in which we participate. I mean, even things like we're actually told to pray for others, for
yes.
each other. I mean,
beautiful.
Very so super clear in other ways, or even
yes.
having children. God doesn't just keep creating children. He has you come together, and we participate even in that. And just
beautiful.
He just seems to be really into participation.
That's
so,
right.
So it's kind of making right. sense.
Yes.
But two things. One is
beautiful.
In looking at Protestant commentary,
yes.
what keeps coming up is, well, the word used, I think it's the Greek word, is like phlipsis or something like that.
Yeah, for suffering.
Is never used as to refer to what Christ suffered. But then I thought of
that's not true.
Isaiah, and I don't know what Greek word it used, but it's translated as in Isaiah 53 that he was afflicted. So, okay, if you could help me with that. And
sure.
Then,
yeah, but let me, real quick there,
like?
Because phlipsis, the Greek word for suffering, is used in Colossians 1:24. Gosh, you're bringing back memories. I remember way back in 1986. When my good friend, Father Mitch Pacwa, was debating Dr. Walter Martin, Martin made that very argument. Actually, it was John Ankerberg who made the argument. And Walter Martin said, amen, brother. And Father pointed out, no, the word is used in Colossians 1:24, where St. Paul says, I fill up that which is lacking in the sufferings of Christ, same Greek word, in my body for his body, which is the church. You can't get any more plain than that text. And the only thing Ankerberg and Martin could say is, well, that's not talking about actual suffering with the sufferings of Christ. It's actually talking about proclaiming the gospel in the midst of suffering. So it's not the suffering, but it's the proclamation of the gospel that saves souls. And I tell you, when I heard it, it just rang so hollow with me. Okay, so I fill up that which is lacking in the sufferings of Christ in my body for which, you know, in my body for his body, which is the church. That's the preaching of the gospel? Really? No, it's not. This is the great gift that we have as Christians. You know, let me add to what we were talking about before. In fact, I'm so glad you called back. This is great because I remember when we hung up, we ran out of time. And I was like, oh, I had a lot more I would like to share. But I remember my spiritual director, who was also my Greek professor when I was in the seminary, he said, you know, in understanding what you're talking about here, that's participatio, whether we're talking about our being mediators, right? Jesus Christ is the one mediator between God and men. Absolutely. And yet, in the same context of 1 Timothy 2:5, when it says that there's one God, one mediator between God and men, the man Jesus Christ, if you back up to verse 1, St. Paul says, first of all, I exhort you, brethren, that prayers, supplications, thanksgivings, be made for all, for kings, for leaders, and for all men. Why? For God wills all to be saved. Why? For there is one, I'm skipping down there to verse 4 and then verse 5, there's one mediator between God and men, the man Jesus Christ. And then you go to verse 7, for this reason I was called to be an apostle. Right? So think of what's happening here. Paul is saying, I want all of you to be mediators, because remember, intercessor and mediator are synonyms, right? What is a priest by definition, but a mediator between God and men, right? Well, we're all priests. I learned that in Baptist Sunday school, man, when I was 8 years old. We're all priests. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 5 through 9. How can we all be priests, which is a mediator between God and men, if Jesus Christ is the only mediator between God and men? Because of what you're saying so well. You already said it. Because we participate in part in that which Christ alone possesses infinitely and absolutely. And we can talk about our being intercessors, mediators, which are synonyms, right? That's what a priest is. We can talk about all of the gifts that we function in the New Testament. We could talk about bishops, pastors, right? 1 Peter 2:25 says that Jesus Christ is the shepherd and bishop, poimena, which is pastor. He is the shepherd and episcope, or episkopos, shepherd and bishop of our souls, right? He is the one shepherd, the one bishop. He is the good shepherd of John 10. Well, guess what? We got lots of shepherds. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, right? There, the Holy Spirit has placed in the church prophets, pastors, evangelists, teachers, right? How is that? If Jesus is the one shepherd, how can there be lots of shepherds? If Jesus is the one bishop, how can there be lots? You know, and we could literally go down the list, right? Jesus Christ in Matthew chapter 23, verse 10, he is our one leader, right? And yet that same Greek word for leader or master in Matthew 23 is used in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17, submit yourselves to your leaders who are over you in the Lord, right? And I literally, we could do the whole hour just showing how that basically all the gifts that we function in as Christians in the New Testament are first and foremost in Christ infinitely, right? And we simply participate in that which Christ alone possesses absolutely. And the same is true when it comes to suffering. So Paul says, yes, Jesus Christ is the one mediator between God and men. He alone suffered and died for our sins. I think we mentioned this when you were on the air with me on Tuesday. 1 John chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Christ is the propitiation for our sins, and not only our sins, but the sins of the whole world. It's through his suffering and death on the cross that we are saved. And yet, what does Jesus say in Luke 9, 23? Unless you take up your cross and follow me, you cannot be my disciple. Right? And it's funny, I said to what's your name again? Cy Kellett. I said to him after we got off the air, I said, oh, I wish I would have mentioned 1 Timothy 4:16, where St. Paul says to a young bishop that he had ordained, Timothy, a young priest, or young bishop, we believe in the tradition, he was a bishop, but Timothy, he says, take heed unto yourself and unto the teaching, for in so doing, you will both save yourself and those that hear thee. So when it comes to salvation itself, we participate in, and as you know, we mentioned the last time, priests in an instrumental sense, all of us in a secondary sense. And what that means is the priest in an instrumental sense, when he confects the Eucharist, he could be the worst sinner in the world, but if he confects the Eucharist, that's Jesus. And there is no impairment whatsoever to that sacrament because the sacraments operate what we call ex opera operato in Latin, which means out of the act, it has acted, right? That's an instrumental causality. But we're called to be secondary causes in salvation, which means, Cy Kellett and Tim Staples, if we pray more, we fast more, we work and pray and read and listen and study, we can be more effective in the way we bring Jesus to people, and we can affect the numbers of people we help. That's called secondary causal, a secondarily causal relationship in affecting whatever it is we're affecting. And so when we're talking about, you know, us praying for people, hey, there are some who have gifts of the Holy Spirit in ways that others don't. The gift of conversion, like Pope St. John Paul, Padre Pio, had gifts of conversion. They were so holy, people could just walk into their presence and fall down and say, I want to go to confession, right?
Yeah, yeah.
They're so holy, and they have this gift of conversion that sort of thing happens. You see that in the scriptures, you know, with St. Paul. They would just touch a handkerchief to his body and take it to someone and touch them, and they would be healed because of the gift. That's in Acts chapter 19, verse 20. We see that with Jesus in Matthew 19, the woman just wanting to touch the tassel of his garment, right? So, you know, you and I, if we work hard and we're praying and we're holy, we can be a better, more perfect sort of instrument for God in that secondary, causal sense, and we can bring about more souls being saved. And that's why Paul, and I did mention this to you last time, in 1 Corinthians 9:22, he'll say, for this reason, I've become all things to all men that by all means I might save some. Romans 11:14, he says he wants to save his brethren after the flesh, the Jews, right? Save them. He says, provoke them to jealousy, whatever I have to do in order to save some of them, right? Now, why is all this a reality? Why and how can this be? It's real simple in this sense. As Father Brandon, God rest his soul, the holiest, smartest priest I ever knew, I think the smartest person I think I've ever known. But Father Brandon put it in simple terms all those years ago in the seminary. He said, here's the bottom line. John 15:5, Jesus says, apart from me, you can do nothing. Not some things. He said nothing. Why? Because the first principle of merit in the soul, in the life of a Christian, is the charity of Christ. It's what Paul said in Galatians 2:20, right? I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I live, but Christ lives in me, and the life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God who gave himself for me. So notice, it's not me, it's Christ in me, but at the same time, it is me. Because I have to cooperate with that grace. And that's why, you know, the scriptures can be so replete with examples of how we save souls, we heal, we can do all sorts of things, even though it's Christ in us. But why is it also us? Because there is that secondary causal relationship. So here's again, John 15:5. Apart from me, you can do nothing, right? But what about, Father Brandon said, what about when you get in Christ, what can you do? Right? Philippians chapter 4, verse 13, St. Paul says, I can do all things, not through Christ. It actually says in Greek, in Christ who strengthens me. So notice, outside of Christ, what can I do? Zip. In Christ, I can do all things, and that includes merit salvation, right? Not by my own strength. It's not of works, lest any man boast. Absolutely not, because it doesn't come from me. That is from my nature. It comes from Christ who empowers me, right? I can do all things, including meriting eternal life, and not only for myself, but for others. In the sense of meriting, in the sense of through our merits, as Paul says it in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 6. He says, if I suffer, I think he uses the word we there. He says, if we suffer, if I suffer, it is for your salvation and consolation, which is made effectual in you enduring the same sufferings that we suffer. Is that Catholic or what, Cy Kelly?
That's Catholic.
I mean, that's what we're talking about. It's all about being in Christ. And once we get in Christ, then, oh my goodness, through the power of Christ, we can do all sorts of things. And that's where redemptive suffering, cooperation and salvation, both for ourselves and for others, comes in. And I'll leave you with one more text there, and that's go to James 5:19-20, where James says, if anyone sees a brother in sin and warns him of his sin, what will happen? He said, let him know he will have, and he repents of his sin, of course, let him know he will have saved a brother from his sin. He will have saved a soul. That's what we're talking about. Now, I can tell you, sister, that when I was Protestant, we would never say that. I just saved a soul, praise God. We would never say that. We would say that's blasphemy. Well, guess what? James did, and so does St. Paul. He says it all over the place. And why is that? Because they were Catholic. Does that make sense? Is she gone?
No, she's still there. Does that make...
No, I am... I think I told you on Tuesday that my brain had exploded when I was reading Sister Faustina, and I think the same thing just happened, but in a very different way.
Okay.
Like, all the pieces are kind of fitting together, and praise this God. Is just so not how I fought for so long.
Oh,
but
yeah,
it
yeah.
just makes so much sense.
Yes.
Well,
praise God.
So, Kim, Can I ask, how do you do this? How do you suffer and have that affect someone? I mean, at a very practical.
Can you wait through the break to get an answer?
Yes. Yeah, just hang in there.
All right, hang on. We'll be right back with more Open Forum on Catholic Answers Live.
Hang on. Catholic Answers Live will return in a moment.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
One of the biggest mistakes a Christian can make is to try to do good without God's help. Saint Therese said, when we trust only ourselves and not God, our soul becomes incapable of virtue. Her remedy? Works of charity. And the greatest work of charity is to share the gospel. At St. Paul Street Evangelization, a Catholic nonprofit, we encourage you to share the gospel with someone who doesn't know Jesus. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. StreetEvangelization.com.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
I don't like looking back. I prefer to look forward and keep moving forward. There's plenty to cover. I do a lot of research and try to dig out the bits and pieces of a life or of an agenda that people don't want to talk about.
The World Over with Raymond Arroyo. Tonight, 8 Eastern, on EWTN Radio and Television.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Keel is on the line. And I got to tell you, Keel, Tim's not kidding. He was concerned after that last time you spoke. He said, oh, I wish I had talked about, it was the letter to Timothy, right?
Yes.
So you had a
follow-up. You know what? He did, because I took notes and I have down 1 Timothy 4:16.
Oh, I did.
You know what I did, though? He's a better person than he thought
yes.
he was.
No, Keel, what I did was I mentioned it. But I didn't quote it because we were out of time. So I did mention, right. I said, and check out also 1 Timothy 4:16 because I didn't have time.
So what was the follow-up question? Now I've forgotten what Keel just asked.
Yeah, what Keel asked, and thank you, Keel, because this is fantastic. She said, now, how do you do it? Yeah. How do you actually, you know, get this to happen? And you know what, Keel? It is so simple. It is just a matter of the intellect and will, just as in any human action. That's all you need. The intellect knows, hey, this is what I should do. The will engages, and you act, and that's all you need. So you want to offer your suffering. Let's say, you know, when I had a stroke 2.5 years ago, man, I had so many opportunities. I could just line up the people that I could that I could bless. And all you have to do is mention it. You know, and it doesn't have to be, you don't have to do a certain, you know, some exercise in, you know, I got to stand up and kneel down and do all this. No, you can be completely silent, and in your heart of hearts, you just simply say, I offer this suffering for my wife. I offer this suffering for my kids. I offer. It can just be a thought in your head. And if we as Christians would understand that we are the most powerful people in the universe because of our baptism, we have been incorporated into, I'm getting goosebumps right now, because when you get incorporated into Jesus Christ, you are incorporated into God, the God-man, the most powerful being in the universe. And so you're tapping in like into an electric plug here, and his power is sourcing through your veins. And so when you say, you know, I offer this for whomever I am offering it for, that is power. And saying prayers for, praying for, it's the same principle, but it works in transforming the universe. Understanding, of course, Romans chapter 6, verse 3, right? We are buried together with him through baptism, so that just as Christ was raised in newness of life, we may be raised in newness of life. Because we're buried together with him, we're raised with him, and we experience that resurrected life. And we say, you know what? I can't keep this to myself. I'm going to share this with everybody I can. And just by saying a prayer, offering this sacrifice, offering. And you know what? What's really cool, Keel, is you. It's not just a matter, Si, of offering sacrifices and suffering, although that's huge, but our joys. You know, 1 Corinthians 12:26, St. Paul says, because we're members of the body of Christ. In fact, if you go back, you know this, Keel, because you know your New Testament. You go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 21, and St. Paul says, can the eye say to the hand, I have no need of thee? Can the head say to the foot, I have no need of thee? The answer is no, right? We need each other. But in verse 26, he says, if one member suffers, all suffer. If one member rejoices, all. How in the world does that work?
Oh, man.
Is that cool?
My gosh.
So if one
member. How many times have I wondered that?
Yes. So if one member is rejoicing, guess what? Bring everybody else in with you,
you know? Yeah.
And say, I'm offering my joys. In fact, we have a prayer we say with our kids every morning. You know, we offer our prayers, our joys, our suffering in union with the Holy Sacrifice of Mass said throughout the world. You know, and we have a litany of other things we say. But, you know, those aren't just words. That is power. When you understand you're a member of the body of Christ, so we're connected to one another. So when we offer our prayers and joys and whatever, we're affecting other members of the body of Christ. And then, of course, even beyond the body of Christ, through our petitions, we're changing lives. Is that cool or what, Keel?
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, it is. Thank you.
I have a feeling you're going to call back when Tim's on again, because you're going to process this now, huh?
I was just thinking that.
And Keel, think about how you and I were taught. I was taught from the time I was a kid that this is blasphemy because it's taking away from the sufficiency of the sacrifice of Christ. That's what Martin Luther taught. That's what John Calvin taught, unfortunately. What they did not understand is we're not taking away from the sufficiency of the sacrifice of Christ. We are participating, and you got it, Keel, because you used that word, participatio. We are participating in the sacrifice of Christ and in his merits. That is the principle whereby we become grace machines.
Grace machines, I like that.
Well, we'll look forward to talking with you again, Keel, all right?
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Yeah,
God bless.
And if there's anything that we publish that would be helpful to you, just I'll tell you what, I'll put you on hold. You can tell Edgar
or you
can think about it.
Keel, do you have my book, Behold Your Mother?
Keel?
I do. No, I'm thinking about it because I just bought Joe Heschmeyer's on the Eucharist, but no, I do not think I have that one.
Well, we're going to send you out a gift, Keel. You just hang on the phone, and I want you to read my book, Behold Your Mother, because I have a whole chapter, well, two chapters, one on the plan of salvation and then Mary's role in God's plan of salvation, where I talk about all of this and more. You are going to love it.
Keel, hang on. We'll get an address for you, and we'll send you off Behold Your Mother. I wanted to ask you about something related to what, because you were talking about, you know, making an offering of your suffering.
Yes.
But, like, I have heard people who will kind of like, and I guess it's mostly saints, but they don't have a specific person they're offering it for.
Sure.
They just say, for whatever you can do that? You can just turn it over to Jesus and let him do what he wants with it?
Si, you always bring up the stuff that needs to be brought up.
Oh, do I really? aren't I good
no,
as a
but
host?
that's so important, but you're right. You can, and that's true about indulgences and everything else. You can offer it for somebody specifically, or you can just generally say, for whoever is in need, Lord, and your will be done. And what you find is that great saints, when they're in terrible suffering, that tends to be the norm.
Yeah.
My wife, who is one of the most incredible human beings on the planet Earth, all seven of her labors, she offered up for particular people, and she would call out their names during labor.
Really?
Oh,
God,
my gosh.
God bless her. Wow.
And we had nurses in the delivery room crying
Oh,
I am serious.
Yeah,
on
yeah.
more than one
it's
occasion.
It's a beautiful witness. It really is a beautiful witness.
It's an incredible witness. So yes, but you just offer it up and say, Lord, your will be done. That's beautiful.
What a great conversation with Keel. I'm sorry to those we didn't get to, but we'll come back and do this all again tomorrow. Well, first of all, Tim, thank you very much. I enjoyed the hour.
And great to be with you,
and
brother.
The conversation we had before, which will be coming out on Catholic Answers Focus.
Yes.
We recorded earlier this afternoon. That'll do it for us. For this episode, however, we'll see you next time, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.